Well, good evening, and there I am. Welcome to The Dividing Line. I'm coming to you live from West Texas. Almost. Well, you know, no, I'm still, you know, I still got like 120 miles to go till I cross into, but that's actually south of New Mexico. Anyways, I'm in West Texas. And man, fought the headwind today. Love my truck. She handled it just great, but you could tell that it was happening. I was down to 7 miles to the gallon. But still, you know, pulling 16,000 pounds behind you with a 25 to 30 mile an hour headwind at 65 to 70, probably about, got up to maybe 72 a couple times today. Speed limit was 80, and I just don't go that fast. Yeah, that's not half bad. It's supposed to get down in the 40s tonight. I'm really looking forward to that. It was so hot and humid this trip. I was really looking forward to having some cool nights, and we'll have a 40s tonight, upper 30s tomorrow night. I'll get a little something. Yeah. And quick story here, and then we're going to do some other stuff. So, like I said, really windy yesterday, too. Rainstorms, the truck's all dirty now and stuff like that. And I see this vehicle coming up behind me, and I get passed by this beautiful, beautiful diesel pusher. So it's basically the size of a Greyhound bus, but it's a mobile home, and they're pulling a 1500 truck behind it. So it's long, but it's just beautiful. Looks really brand new. And they passed me, and I don't know why it was, but I said to myself, I bet we're going to the same place. Now, we were probably 40, 50 miles away from this place. But for some reason, I thought, I have a feeling we're going to the same RV park. Well, I pull in the RV park, one I've never stayed at before. Every once in a while, I'll try to grab one that I've not stayed at before just to see, because sometimes you'll find a real gem, sometimes not so much. I certainly didn't find a gem in Mobile, but I did... I'd stay at that park that I stayed at last night again, in Big Spring, Texas. And really nice park that I found right after Mobile. I forget what it was called, but I made a note of it. Anyway, I pull in, and they're registering. They're right in front of me. And we ended up parked next to each other. Very common. They have pull-through sites that they put their single-nighters in, so you can just get in and out real quick and get back on your way. And so I started talking to the guy from Mesa, Arizona. Apologia is in Mesa right now, anyways. And so I was just bold. Here, let me show you what we've got here. I was just sort of bold, and I said, "What does something like that cost?" And you can just barely see the truck in the back, just barely, just right at the back. It's hard to see from that angle. But I was, you know, I was being a little nosy. I don't mean to be nosy, but what does something like that cost? And he didn't have any problem telling me. $982,000. That's, you know, I think you can round that up to an even cool $1 million. And they had a 2022, I think. This is a 2025. It's brand new. This is their first trip with it. The whole roof is solar panels and Starlink. Starlink's built into this thing. It's got automatic driving and all the lane stuff and everything. It's got it all. And it was so quiet when those slides were coming out and stuff like that. So. Guess what's parked right over there in the next row? We ended up, they're here again. I guess since I'm always behind them, I'm following them, but I didn't intend to. They're here because they're going back to going back to Mesa, I'm going back to same spot. So I'm wondering if we'll run into each other at the last stop. Tomorrow's a long leg, the longest leg of the trip, both coming out and coming back. I did the same. I just mirrored everything going back and forth, basically. So tomorrow's 120 miles farther than today. I hope it's not as windy tomorrow. That'd be a lot of effort tomorrow going back. But anyway, so I just thought it. Sometimes you see some amazing stuff out here, and you know, my unit. This is a big unit for a fifth wheel. It's there are bigger ones. I've seen bigger ones. Regularly see ones that are three, four feet longer. But she's definitely on the big size. So when I was parked next to her, it's not like I got dwarfed or something like that, but still just the paint job and just all the fancy stuff. You may hear a little bit of, you may notice that the rocks behind me, if you look really carefully, aren't really rocks. They're moving. there's a beautiful, like I said, it's windy, beautiful, cool breeze. The sun's setting, and I got to let that air through. It's great. By the way, I'll just tell you one other RV story from this morning. I went out to – I hadn't parked real wisely. I hadn't really watched the passenger side where my door is. And I ended up pretty much in a tree as far as trying to get the stairs down and get in the door. But I was already hooked up, so I was like, I'm sticking with it. So I didn't close the door. When I opened the door, I kept it open, and I just went out. And it was cool. It was like in the 40s. And I was taking my first trip out the truck. You got stuff to take out there, the water you're going to be drinking, any snacks you're going to have, stuff like that. I come walking up the steps, and as soon as I come in, I can sense something. And I look over here, and there is a bird that has flown into the unit because I left the door open. And it wasn't one of the little sparrow things. Head to tail is about yay big. It's like a raven type. Well, it wasn't quite as big as a raven. I don't know. I probably could have identified its genus and species when I was in college as a biology major. But the poor thing kept running into the windows and thinking that was the way out. And it hurt to hear it go plunk. And I'm trying to get it to the door. I'm pulling the shades down so it doesn't run into those windows. And I've already had to pick up a little bit of bird poop that I'll probably find some more of. You know, the thing was scared to death. Ended up flying down to the other end, and I had to try to get it around. Let's just say I can think of a lot of speakers at big conferences that would not be chasing that bird around. Let alone hooking up sewer pipes and that kind of stuff. Eventually, he or she found its way out the door, and I hope it was not mortally wounded from its frequent encounters with windows. Just another exciting experience on the road. I was sitting. On Sunday, I spoke at a CREC church plant in Granbury, Texas. One of my best friends in all of life, Jeff Neal, you know the name because he and I wrote the same-sex controversy together. I also wrote the chapter on Hebrews 7 through 10 in response to him because he became a paedobaptist. I did not. So we've had that to deal with. I preached at his ordination installation with Greg Bonson's father there many years ago back in Phoenix. He had moved to Texas a while ago, had a stroke a number of years ago, and has recovered so well. I mean, he still has to take it really easy and things like that. But what a godly man. He and his wife, Denise, they had their little grandkids there. Their grandkids are young. Well, okay. I've got grandkids as young as his. Ransom's that young. But all my other grandkids, my oldest granddaughter will be 15 next month. So they were all there. And the funny thing, I get there and they're like, the church was struck by lightning a few hours ago. So we had to set up in the little gym type thing. So it wasn't there. The only time they'd ever had to do it, is the time I'm visiting. So, but it worked out great anyways. And the thing was, when Jeff had first talked to me, he had said, "Hey, there's another church plant out here that I'd love to have you speak at as well. Could you speak there at like 10 o'clock in the morning for their Sunday school and then drive out here to Granbury?" And I was like, "Sure, you know, I can speak at two places if you want." Yeah. Until I started looking at the map the day before. And I'm like, "Jeff, are you trying to kill me?" When I figured it out, if I had gone to the other church, which was way east, it was out toward Lyndale, which is where Tom Buck is. If I had driven out there and then driven to Granbury and then driven back, I would have driven 300 miles, 4 hours of driving, not including all the construction and stuff in Fort Worth, Dallas area, along the 20. I contacted the first pastor and said, "You know, I come through the 20 fairly regularly. How about I, we make a deal that I can come by and do something a little more substantive for you in the future, but 300 miles on a Sunday is just a little bit on a little bit too much." And he said, "Oh, sure, I fully understand." So I think Jeff was trying to kill me with that. But anyway, I've spoken when Jeff was at All Saints in Fort Worth before going out to this church plant. I've spoken there, and now I've spoken at this church, and they're much more liturgical, or much more of an emphasis on liturgy, the congregational response, praise be to Christ, thanks be to God, things like that, than what I'm accustomed to. But it's so well done, and they know how to do it really well, that it's really beautiful. And the kids were fantastic. We did have some visitors that came out because I was going to be there, so I thought that was great. But just a wonderful church, wonderful folks. Jeff knows all the kids by their first name, and it's wonderful to see that. And I hope to have the opportunity of visiting again in the future, because it was very, very enjoyable. And I should tell you, the thoughts I want to share with you from Scripture during the program this evening mainly came from the sermon that I delivered there at Granbury on Sunday afternoon at 2 o'clock, which was really didn't bother me at all. I mean, I'm used to Sunday afternoon stuff now. Given that Apologia meets at 4, so but it was great. And as I was leaving, having spent a lot of time talking to a lot of folks after the service, including some visitors that had come out, one fellow on Twitter that I had told about it, and he came out, and it was great to meet him. There was these two young men, I'd say 8 to 11 range, somewhere in there. And they both came up and shook my hand and said, "Thank you, Dr. White, for preaching today." And I was very impressed. And their mom was walking by with them, and she just smiled at me and said, "Tell Summer I love her." And I was like, I'm very proud to just be Summer's dad now for a lot of folks. I think that's super and awesome and great. And that was really neat. So, getting into those churches and getting to talk with people and meet with people and stuff like that was great. Oh, I should have grabbed. Oh, it's in the other room. I'm sorry. This young lady made me a really nice. I don't know. It's a bracelet type thing, but it's a really intricate beading type stuff. She gave that to me. I've got it in the other room there. And so again, just wonderful folks. And it's, you don't hear a lot about churches like that, but man, that's where so much of the real building of the kingdom takes place. It really does. And it's exciting to get those opportunities. Here we are, and it is election night in the United States of America, and I think a number of you are probably, if you're watching, I don't know how many are watching. I can't imagine very many, to be honest with you. You're trying to escape the wall-to-wall coverage. The only thing I'll say about it is this. I was listening to Fox News as I was driving. I have Sirius XM, and so I was listening to Fox News as I was driving, and then it started just getting repetitious. Because what are you supposed to say? There are no results to talk about or anything like that. It's just the same old all over again. Uh-oh. Da-da-da. Oh, 518 watching. So there's 518 of you that don't want to necessarily. You probably got the news coverage on the other side. Anyway, I just got this crazy idea, and I switched over. I had to look for it a little bit, but I switched over to MSNBC. I just gotta tell you, that was scary. That was scary. I really understand. If Trump wins, those people are gonna burn the nation down. I've just never seen anything like it. It was frightening. I would not want to live that kind of life. The fear. Wow, it was. I could only handle it for so long before I'm just like, "Oh, this is creepy. They might find out I'm listening. I better get out of here." Just turned it off. It's like, sad, very, 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 very sad. But anyway, so what I'd like to do is invite you to take your scriptures. Maybe go ahead and turn that TV off for a while. Nothing earth-shattering is going to happen between now and the end of the hour. Think with me about some divine truths from the 33rd Psalm. As I said, that's what I addressed at the CRAC Church in Granbury. And Jeff seemed to enjoy the sermons, so and other people did too. And it certainly did cause me to think through a number of issues that are certainly relevant on election day in the United States. And I know that the rest of the world doesn't have election day today, but my goodness, the number of people outside the United States that are following this and are concerned about it, know more about it than a lot of us do, is amazing. Now, of course, we've talked about Psalm 33 many times. I've preached it. I know that at least at PRBC, maybe at Apologia, but at least at PRBC, I do remember at one point preaching all of Psalm 33 just from the Hebrew text, as I recall. I remember printing it out in nice big fonts, and I have it in nice big fonts in front of me right now. But you also know that we have brought this up because it's directly relevant to false teachings like open theism. It contains a very strong affirmation of not only God's sovereignty, but how God's sovereignty directly interacts with man's will, man's plans, man's counsel, man's intentions. And so it is a text I have raised in those contexts and have always found that the other side will either run from it, just not even mention it, or the responses that they offer are just extremely shallow and easily refuted. The text is very clear and very strong. So if you've turned to Psalm 33, And isn't it interesting that here we are in 2024? And so, you know, we don't know when Psalm 33 was written or collected or anything like that, but you're probably talking at least 2,750 to 3,000 years. It depends. I mean, exactly where you place it and authorship issues and things like that. But it's very old, and for many people, hence very irrelevant. And, you know, I'll just remind you that we as Christians need to purposefully cultivate the commitment to hold the same view of Scripture that Jesus did. I think that's really important. If you're going to trust him for your eternal salvation, you should probably trust his view of Scripture too. And we can know what that view of Scripture is. Not difficult at all. A few months ago, I preached a sermon apologia. It was an online sermon because for the first time since I've been there, we were not able to have a Sunday service together. Had nothing to do with COVID or the government. It had everything to do with Sherwin-Williams. They had painted and sealed the gym floor, which is right next to the worship center. And the fumes were unbelievable. Uninhabitable. Everybody would have died. So I did a sermon, and my sermon was Jesus' view of Scripture. So if you want to look that up, might be of use to you. So here we are, ancient words directly relevant to where we are today, directly relevant to what's going on right now. And in fact, I think a really good antidote to counteract maybe any worries and concerns we have about what is going to happen in our land. Psalm 33, sing for joy in Yahweh, O Zadikim, the righteous ones, the ones who are upright. And notice the parallelism, praise is becoming to the upright. In Hebrew poetry, it is very common to parallel phrases if you want to expand their meaning and to, especially because Hebrew does have a smaller vocabulary range. It's a very ancient language. The way to express it with more color and to say, this is the area of meaning of this first term that I'm focusing on, you use parallelism. And so, righteous ones, upright. Sing for joy in Yahweh, O righteous ones. Praise is becoming to the upright. And so he's talking about those who are upright, who are righteous, the saints, the believing people, the people who worship Yahweh. And they are called to sing for joy in Yahweh. This is something that God's people have always done. And even if you don't have much of a talent in that area, or like me, talent you once had in that area has degraded greatly as you've gotten older. Still sing, though I must admit right now, I forgot to put them in today. They're sitting right there. But I don't have my hearing aids in. Having hearing aids makes singing a little bit scary, I'll have to admit. But I'm still trying to do it, despite having to sort of learn how it's supposed to work. Give thanks to Yahweh with the lyre. Sing praises to him with a harp of 10 strings. So use the skills, if God has given you the skill to play musical instruments. I don't know, you know, I know there are people that try to get around this kind of text, but I think God gave us that ability and he wants us to use it. Sing to him a new song. Play skillfully with a loud shout. For, why? Why should we be doing all these things? For the word of Yahweh is upright. He'd already used that term up in the first verse to describe people. But now the word of Yahweh is upright, and all his work is done in faithfulness. And that term faithfulness there is the same term that comes eventually into Latin and then into the English language as amen. It is true. It is faithful. It is consistent. His work, what he does in this world, is done in faithfulness. There is a consistency to it. So, immediate application where we are, I don't know who's going to win tonight. I don't know what's going to happen with the Senate or the House or anything else. But if we believe that God works his will, then we, you know, my prayer is for one thing. My prayer is for the ability and freedom to preach for righteousness and to restrain evil. And I obviously believe one side is significantly more intent upon spreading evil and defining that which is evil as good, defining what is good as evil. But if God should, in his sovereignty, work, do, all his work is done in faithfulness, something that I don't want, I know that what he's doing is according to truth. It's according to his character. It may be very much a part of judgment, which I pray we can be mercifully delivered from. But my commitment is, the biblical commitment of one who is a righteous one of the followers of Christ, is that his work is done in faithfulness. And I may not be able to see it, and I may be disappointed, and I may feel great concern about the future. But his work is done in faithfulness, and I can lay my pillow on the bed tonight. I don't think we're going to know what the outcome is this evening. It could be wrong, but whatever it is, I can lay my head on the pillow tonight and know that his work is done in faithfulness. Furthermore, we have the assertion, verse 5, he loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of the chesed of Yahweh. Chesed Yahweh, Milah Ha'aretz, the loving kindness, covenant faithfulness of Yahweh fills the earth. The number of terms here in verse 5 that are just vitally important to know and to rejoice in, honestly. He loves Zedekah. Zedekah, righteousness. And don't get distracted by immediately trying to read Old Testament text in New Testament contexts. Let the Old Testament speak first, and then let the New Testament interpret that in its own way. But righteousness and justice, they're put together. So tzedakah wa mishpat. Mishpat. Justice. God loves these things. In fact, another psalm somewhere in the 90s, says that justice is the foundation of his throne. And so this is a description of his character. And therefore, when his character is displayed in his creation, he loves righteousness and justice. But we need to understand that there are many people today that will partially quote texts like this without recognizing and submitting to the fact that God gets to define righteousness and justice. We don't get to do that. Social justice, stuff like that. I'm hoping I'm not getting eaten alive here. Sorry. Social justice. No. God, Yahweh's law defines what righteousness is. Yahweh's law defines what justice is. And he loves that. And therefore, if we want to see his righteousness and justice done in this world, if we want to see that done, which he is going to love, then we have to let him define that. And that's what we must be working toward, not some concept that we come up with. Psalm 33:5b is certainly one that a lot of people have memorized, but it's a beautiful, beautiful phrase. The earth is full of the chesed of Yahweh. I've told you before that for a while I had a vanity plate on my, well, I forget which one, I think I had it on my Versa. I had a Nissan Versa for a while. But it was chesed, C-H-E-S-E-D, chesed, the Hebrew term for loving kindness, covenant faithfulness. And I didn't enjoy it as much as I could have because my wife said that that made it the cheesehead car. Thank you, dear. Appreciate that. Paying extra money each year for that, and you call it the cheesehead car. I don't have it anymore. But chesed is the Hebrew term that contains within itself, in its uses, love, grace, mercy, so many of the things that we say, well, that's just the New Testament God. No. No. When you talk about the chesed of Yahweh, that's saying the exact same thing. This was something that clearly the Gnostics didn't understand because they differentiated between the God of the Old and the God of the New. It is without a doubt one of the most, if you love the term grace in the New Testament, then chesed should be one of your favorite terms in the Old. Psalm 33:6, by the word of Yahweh, the heavens were made, and by the breath of his mouth, all their host. He gathers the waters of the sea as a heap. He lays up the deeps in storehouses. Let all the earth fear Yahweh. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. For he spoke and it was. He commanded and it stood. Now, these verses, these stanzas of the poem, because that's what they are, focus upon the reality of Yahweh as creator, maker, and sustainer. In my opinion, much of the weakness in modern theology and practice is because we may say on Sunday that we believe that by the word of Yahweh the heavens were made, but in our thinking, in our thoughts, during the rest of the week, we don't live that way. We don't think that way. And we are embarrassed by the Bible's revelation of God as creator. Because we know in our society that is unpopular, backwards. You might not get advancement at work if people know that's what you believe. And yet, again, there isn't any question, Matthew 19:1, the creator from the beginning made the male and female. Jesus was a creationist. And smartest man I know in the world is a young earth creationist. Jason Lyle, of course. By the word of Yahweh, the heavens were made, and by the breath of his mouth, all their hosts. And we are learning much more about the host. And you might say, well, the host, they were talking about spiritual beings. Well, yeah, maybe. But if we're talking about the heavens and their host, the stars, we now know so much more. And with the James Webb Space Telescope now providing just astonishing images of God's creation, we are we may be able to see things. We see things now that mankind never, ever, ever saw. And the unregenerate mind goes, see, we don't need God anymore. We now can now see these things. So you can see them. You still don't know where it came from. You can't explain its origin, why it's so beautiful to us. You can't explain any of those things. Professing to be wise, they became fools. God made these things. He gathers the waters of the sea as a heap. He lays up the deeps and storehouses. You study oceanography. You study the currents. You study, you know, they find new creatures all the time that we've never seen before. Or sometimes they'll find a creature at incredible depths that they thought had been gone for millions of years and all this kind of stuff. We don't even have a full understanding of how our oceans work. I was looking at something. I saw something on Twitter. It was a picture, a drone shot, I think. Might have been a plane, but looked like a drone shot, of where the Pacific and Atlantic oceans meet. And you can literally see the difference in color, and there's almost a line in the water. Different salinities, temperatures. It's fascinating. It is absolutely fascinating. The problem is, a person who is not looking at the world as the handiwork of their maker and their creator looks at that and thinks that their knowledge, I have now gained knowledge of these things, and therefore that means I don't need God any longer. And you and I, we look at it and our hearts are filled with worship and a recognition of our smallness, of, you know, even if we know things, you know, we know things today. I've used the example of Albireo, that beautiful star. I've shown it on the program before. I'll not show it to you now. Only in the past few hundred years have we known that Albireo is a gloriously beautiful yellow and blue binary star. Now, some arguments about whether it's an optical binary or a natural system, but the point is, it's until we had telescopes, you could not distinguish between the two stars. Now we can, and the beauty of that golden star next to that blue star is still one of the most beautiful things I can look at in the night sky. I confess, my heart is filled with... The same thing happens to me when I see Albireo as the night I was on the Mercury, a cruise ship up in Alaska. And I had heard the captain say that there would probably be... the Northern Lights would probably be out that night. And so while everybody else was going to the shows and stuff like that, I went out to the darkest part of the ship I could find. And I was out there alone. And there were the Northern Lights, the Aurora Borealis. And I literally laid down on the deck because my neck was starting to kill me from looking up at it, watching those shimmering lights. And I started singing How Great Thou Art. And I didn't care if somebody walked up there. I did not care. I was looking at the glorious beauty of my God's creation. Now, by the way, I also have on my phone space weather apps. I have a whole section on solar activity, and I'll get warnings. I'll get notifications of a certain kind of solar flare, and therefore, you know, we've had some Aurora Borealis even this past summer that went way down, way, way, way down south just within the past few weeks. Far, much farther south than it's normally seen. And so we know what causes it. We understand space weather now. We understand the Earth's magnetic field and the interaction of that solar plasma and the electrical charges. And yeah, we know all that. So what? So we finally figured out part of God's creation, which he called us to do in the first place. It doesn't take away from its majesty for a second. I feel sorry for those who think it does. So Let all the earth fear Yahweh. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. When you stand in awe of his creation, you're staying in awe of him, if you know him. If you give credit to him for being the creator, you stand in awe of him. For he spoke and it was. He commanded and it stood. By the way, that was such a different understanding of creation than was held in the ancient world. In the ancient world, the gods came out of creation. In one of the Babylonian myths, you know, you cut this one god in half, and half of it becomes the heavens, and half of it becomes the earth, and this kind of stuff. But the idea of creatio ex nihilo, creation out of or into nothing, seen so clearly here in Psalm 33 now. For he spoke, and it was. He commanded. It stood. It came into existence. It stood forth. His speech, his command is creative because it's God speaking. So, you know, by the word of Yahweh, by his speech, God is a communicating God. Yahweh communicates, and God and Yahweh creates by speaking. Now, I know the word faith people pervert that and say we can do the same thing because we're little gods. Well, their judgment is just, and someday they will answer for such foolishness. So, having said that God creates, he spoke, came into existence, it was. He commanded, it stood forth. So you have the direct assertion of God's creative power, and that it is through his creative power he has created the universe. And it's right then that you get verses 10 and 11, which is where we have focused so much of our attention in years past, and in making application of Psalm 33 in regards to the doctrine of God. Why? Well, you need to see verses 10 and 11 together. I guess, I'm not doing too bad with this stuff. Let's see if we can, there we go. Now, Rich wanted to try to fix the mini-me thing. We never got around to it, but I'm the mini-me down the corner now. Verses 10, 11. So let's put them right up here at the top here so that we don't have anything get in the way. Are in the Hebrew language meant to be seen as contrasting parallels. Yahweh, to break, to bring to nothing, to nullify, the council of the goyim, the council of the nations, he hinders, frustrates, brings to an end the thoughts, plans of the amim. So goyim, amim are your parallels, so the nations and peoples. And then what is God doing? Well, he's nullifying or frustrating the counsel of the nations and the thoughts or the plans, the intentions of the nations. All right? So there's the first assertion, is that Yahweh is the one. So Yahweh, right here, he is the one. This is a verb, active verb. This is something God is doing. This is something Yahweh is doing. He is nullifying the council of the nations. And he, again, another verb, he is hindering, frustrating the thoughts of the peoples. So that's something that Yahweh does. All right? But then in contrast to that, you have the council. And so here's council, here's council. Same term. Boom, boom. Okay. Azath. Azath Yahweh. So his council stands forever. Stands forever. So notice, instead of God doing something here, this is a direct statement about the nature of his, well, it's not really an action, but his counsel. His counsel stands forever. And then notice the thoughts here. Here's the thoughts up here in verse 10, same term, being, I'm not sure why it's, won't go up, there it is. Thoughts here, thoughts there. It is specifically intended to be made a parallel between these two. But it's the thoughts of the peoples up above. Here, it's of his heart. The thoughts of his heart. Now that's a little difficult for us. You know, that sounds like, you know, something we'd talk about in Valentine's, isn't like that. But in the Hebrew way of thinking, and it's from generation to generation, they stand from generation to generation. The thoughts of his heart, this would be his decree. This would be his the accomplishment, his desire, the thoughts of his heart, the innermost purposes of Yahweh from generation to generation. So the contrast is meant to be the nations and the peoples, they can think and plan what they wish. But it is the counsel of Yahweh that stands forever, the intentions and plans of his heart from generation to generation. That is a contrast that must be seen and must be understood by everyone, and certainly by any Christian who would seek to accurately handle the word of God. I don't know how that text could, like I said, every time I've raised that text in debate or in responding to people in written form on the dividing line, the responses from people have simply been pathetic. They really have. They just don't, there's, the words mean what the words mean. The words mean what the words mean. Then we have Psalm 33:12, which I did tell the story, and every time I can't not tell the story that when I first moved to Phoenix 50 years ago, there was a broadcast television station. There was no cable, of course, back then. Channel 10, it was the CBS affiliate in Phoenix. And at the top of each hour, they had the same station ID. You had to give a station ID back then. All broadcasts still do. Cable don't, but broadcast do. And this voice would come on. It would say, "Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord." KOOL-TV, Channel 10, Phoenix. I wonder how many people this day have that first part of this verse memorized. You know, they stopped eventually. They're the Fox affiliate now, so anyway. But for a while there, you know, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Actually, it's blessed is the nation whose God is Yahweh. And that's his covenant name. So blessed is the nation who is in that covenant relationship with Yahweh, the people whom he has chosen for his own inheritance. You want a nation to be blessed? You don't get those blessings by getting on your horse and chopping up the infidels. You don't get that blessing by promoting soil and blood concepts. God chooses people for his own inheritance, and he changes their hearts, and he makes them a people that desire to serve him and worship him and to obey his laws, follow in his ways, the upright, the righteous ones. That's the only way to get blessing. And we need to understand that. This nation, every nation, needs to understand. If you want God's blessing, there's only one way to obtain it. So we are told that Yahweh, verse 13, looks from heaven. He sees all the sons of men. From the place of his habitation, he gazes on all the inhabitants of the earth. He who forms the hearts of them all. He who understands all their works. Wow, is that important? God knows. And that has been a bulwark and a blessing for God's people from the beginning that I think has been lost to us. Because we may affirm in our theology the coming day of judgment, but we don't think about it. We don't live in that reality, in the light of that. And as a result, it's just not a part of... There should be certain presuppositional truths that are so plain in God's word that they, because of our regular exposure to the word of God, become a part, not necessarily of our conscious thought, but of our subconscious pre-thought, so that we know that Yahweh sees everything. We can't hide from him. We can't hide our thoughts from him. Can't hide our behaviors from him. And God knows when we are hurt by others, when we are persecuted, imprisoned, beaten, mocked, whatever it might be, God knows. God knows all the thoughts and intentions of our hearts in every controversy, even amongst Christians. God knows the thoughts and intentions of all of our hearts. From the place of his habitation, he gazes on all the inhabitants of the earth. He who forms the hearts of them all. Forms the hearts of them all. The verb that's used there, yotzer, years and years and years ago. I know Rich had one. I think he had a yellow one. We had these shirts made. We had t-shirts made. And we had long sleeve, I'm pretty sure I had a sweatshirt. I wish someone who still had one could send me a picture of it, because I'd like to make them again. We called it the Witnessing with the Word t-shirt. And it was one of the first things we did like that. I mean, the ministry was tiny at the time. But it was printed on a, and this was still sort of new back then. We had various Hebrew stuff in the Old Testament, and then went down to Greek stuff in the New Testament. I was studying Greek and Hebrew. What do you want? I remember I was wearing one night when I went to Salt Lake City Airport to pick up Tony DeLute, like 2 o'clock in the morning for the general conference. And there was a Jewish guy that saw the Hebrew, and he started talking to me until he read farther down and saw the Greek, and then he just turned around and walked away from me. But one of the texts that we had, I think it was from Isaiah 44. All I remember is it used the same verb. I can't remember people's names anymore, but I can remember what verb was on a t-shirt that we had many, 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 many moons ago. I don't see anything from Rich about saying, "Oh, I still have mine." Was it yellow though? Because I seem to remember seeing you in a yellow t-shirt, the Witnessing with the Word t-shirt. You know, this is back when we were both very young and we could wear t-shirts. Notice I have a shirt over my t-shirt, because once you're past about 35, you need to do that. Anyway, so he who forms, it's creation. It's something God does. And that's what the point of that passage we had on the t-shirt was. He who forms the hearts of them all. He who understands all their works. He knows. You may think you did it in secret. No one will ever know. There have been horrible crimes that have been committed, never been solved. God knows. He understands all their works, and he understands the motivations, the reasons, purposes, everything. Better than we do. Sometimes we go, "Why did I do that?" God knows. God knows. That these are descriptions of, this is a description of God's sovereign knowledge over all that he has created. Then a good word to the United States, which is so arrogant in its military prowess. The king is not saved by a mighty army. A warrior is not delivered by great strength. A horse is a false hope for salvation, nor does it provide escape to anyone by its great strength. Those were the great weapons of the day. I hear that we test fired a hypersonic missile today. The United States did. We have all this, you know, we think that we've got the Space Force now and all that kind of stuff. No nation can thrive and survive without the blessing of God. That's God. That's God stuff. That's God stuff. That's the point there. But anyways, I have been going for a long time here. So coming up on an hour, that's not too bad. I'll actually probably wrap up around. I hope this has been helpful to you, useful to you, get away from all the stuff. Last verses. Behold, the eye of Yahweh is on those who fear him. The fear of Yahweh, beginning of knowledge, beginning of wisdom. And those who live in fear of Yahweh. A couple questions that were asked. I really enjoyed my time at the Fight Laugh Feast thing. It was a big conference. There were a lot of people there. It wasn't as big as G3 yet, but it was big. A lot bigger than I expected it to be. And so I thank Gabe and Toby and Chocolate Knox for inviting me. And I've lost track of how many webcasts I was on while I was there. But one of the things we did during one of the Q&As, actually I think both, is we had some young people ask questions. And a lot of the, some of the really good questions were, how can I as a young person keep myself pure? How can I honor God in my life? And I think one of the best answers is be a God-fearer. The eye of Yahweh is on those who fear him. That's not abject, cowering terror. That is the proper attitude of a person who recognizes every breath of my mouth, every beat of my heart, every gift I possess comes from his hand. I am his creature. He has the right to do with me as he wills. His eye is on the God-fearer. Nothing happens to us he doesn't see. That means everything that does happen to us. Oh, that's the basis of Romans 8:28. All things work together for good. That's what it's about. And by the way, Romans 8:28 is for all Christians, not just for Jews. We'll be talking a little bit more about that again, sadly, in the future. Another description of a God-fearer is the next line, on those who wait for his loving kindness. Those who wait. I am not naturally a patient man. I wasn't a patient child. since we've got a good stream going on here over there, I haven't seen any problems with it. I did tell my parents about this before they died. In third grade, Mrs. McGee, and my mom kept all my grade school and high school report cards, stuff like, and she gave them to me before she passed, so I have them. And I and this other boy named Bobby, we would race each other to see who could get down with our assignments first. And we were both very good students. So it didn't really hurt our grades much, but I did make sometimes some silly mistakes because I was trying to get done before Bobby. And so one report card session, my teacher had written on the report card, Jimmy is a very good student, but often rushes and makes mistakes as a result. And I saw that and I'm like, so what I did is you had to take it home and get the report card signed, bring it back. What I did is I took the report card and I turned it upside down, stuck it in the envelope so that only the signature part, signature area was open, could be seen. That comment was covered. And I waited until we were rushing out the door. I was rushing out the door to catch the bus. Oh, Mom, you forgot to sign the report card. Never saw it. Well, didn't see it until I was probably 35, 40, something like that. At which point in time, it did not have quite the same weight. But just a clear illustration of I'm just not a naturally a waiting person, a patient person. That video camera that I have in the truck, which I think everybody should have one of those in case stupid stuff happens, could testify that there are times I'm not a patient person. It is definitely a character weakness of mine. Though most people say, oh, but in the debates, that's the Spirit of God doing something, and there's a specific purpose to it. Waiting on the Lord, waiting on Yahweh's chesed. That's part of fearing him, because if you recognize he's your God and he's working his purpose in your life, then impatience is impatience with God. It's impatience with his purpose. And I know that. I've known that my entire life, and I still struggle with it. But that's the description. Those who wait for his chesed to deliver their soul from death and to keep them alive in famine. We don't think about famine here in the United States. But we should. When one of the parties is talking about price controls, that's a good way to create famine. Always does. Always has. We may get to experience it. But it was much more common in that day. The ability to provide a consistent, steady food source was one of the greatest tasks in any nation or for any family or anything. So to deliver their soul from death, to keep them alive in famine, God's eyes upon you. You say, but doesn't God at times allow his people to die in the judgment? He does. But if your soul is going to be delivered from death, if you're going to be kept alive in famine, it's because the eye of Yahweh is upon you. He knows his people. And then the last three verses are a prayer. It's a community confession. It goes to the plural. Our soul is patient for Yahweh. He is our help and our shield. For our heart is glad in him because we trust in his holy name. And then the community prays to God. Let your chesed, O Yahweh, be upon us as we wait for you. And so you've got the personal application in the previous verses, and then the communal, our soul is patient for Yahweh. He is our help and our shield. Our heart is glad in him, rejoices him, shout for joy. It's sort of a bookending thing. When you look at the beginning of the psalm and the end, you're repeating the same themes and terms. Very common in Hebrew poetry. Well, ancient poetry as a whole, but for our heart is glad in him because we trust in his holy name. We trust in him no matter what takes place. We trust in his holy name. Therefore, our prayer is, let your chesed, O Yahweh, be upon us as we wait for you. That is I think one of the things that I really enjoyed at the church in Granbury with Pastor Neil. And I'm sorry, I've obviously forgotten the name of the church plant. But that kind of communal confession, that kind of communal participation, I really like that. I really do. Let, you know, I would like to hear the whole congregation together raising their hands and saying, let your chesed, O Yahweh, be upon us as we wait for you. There's something very special about that. There's something very special about God's people. It's so encouraging. We need that encouragement from one another. It's not just me. It's not just me fighting through. It's the people of God. Because then you see yourself as part of that much larger context. That much, God's doing bigger things. I may suggest this. I'm just having a thought here. I may suggest this to our worship leaders and our elders. That's a great text. And I that'd be something neat for our people to memorize and then together as a benediction say together, let your loving kindness, O Yahweh, be upon us as we wait for you. Even before I went to Apologia, Jeff taught everyone to say the Shema, Shema Yisrael, Yahweh Eloheinu, Yahweh Echad. And even the kids can say that. That's not a long verse in Hebrew either. Just having some thoughts here as we're wrapping things up. As I'm sitting out, I'm feeling the cold air coming in. It's getting down in the 40s tonight. I love this place. I want to thank all of you again who's made it possible for me to be in this this thing and travel like this. There is a faux fireplace right there. And I had one in the last one too. And I loved it. I loved it. I love how it looks. It looks just so cool. But it's also a heater. And the last one I had, you could set for different temperatures, the actual 65, 68, something like that. This one's either high or low. That's it. it doesn't turn on and off. It just, you put it on low or you put it on high. So it's a little bit bigger than the other one. So big deal. It's so pretty, so beautiful. That thing's going to be running tonight. And I'll have to get another little space heater. What I really should do, I've never turned the main heater on in this thing. Because there is this, is propane and the stove works. I'm sure it'll be fine, but it'll probably smell to high heaven the first time I do it. I've never used it. I'll need to on the next trip, but I'm going back to, I'll be in St. Charles again, the first full weekend in December, talking about the LGBTQ stuff. For those of you that are back in that area, I'll definitely be needing it then. So I probably should tomorrow morning, when it's really cold, go ahead and fire it up, get that burnt dust smell out, and get it done. But normally, this little thing and a space heater is enough to keep it around 60. And for most guys, that's awesome. You know, the ladies are sitting there like, ah. But for most guys, we're pretty happy with that. So anyways, but yeah, I can feel the cool air is starting to come in, and that's going to be great. So the wind has died down. I was enjoying feeling a little bit the rocking back and forth. That's really cool. That's a lot of fun. And I did get to hear some rain a little bit while I was in the Fort Worth area. That's always a really cool thing, too. So anyway, I hope you enjoyed our walk through Psalm 33. I think it's certainly one of my favorite psalms. And there's, we could have stopped at almost any verse and preached for a long time. But hopefully, especially with everything else going on right now, and no matter what ends up happening tonight or tomorrow or next week, who knows when Maricopa County or Arizona or anything else will, get finished with their counting. no matter what happens, Yahweh's eyes are upon those who fear him. And we can all say together, let your loving kindness be upon us as we wait for you. So if everything is still in turmoil, when it's time to go to bed tonight, go to bed. Sleep as one who fears Yahweh and has his promises. That's what I'm going to do. And I hope you'll do the same thing too. So thank you very much for joining us. Where did I put my music? There it is. Thank you very much for joining us this evening. One last thing. I don't know how we're going to do another program this week. I have something to do from here in Germany on Friday. Maybe we can sneak something in after that. Even though I'll be home, this won't be parked yet, and so we'll still be using it. Because I've only got 2.5 weeks for the next trip. I'm going to be leaving most stuff in here. It's not perishable. Why take it out? It's cool now. It's not going to fry. You can't do that in July, August. Everything melts. I'm traveling Thursday. I'm just not sure if we're going to be able to do a program then. We'll see. We'll do our best. Who knows? Maybe amazing stuff will have taken place, and we just have to do the program somewhere or another. We'll figure it out then. I hope it's not because something terrible has happened, an assassination or something like that. We'll see. We will see. But anyways, thank you very much for listening to the program today, and I hope it was a blessing to you. It was actually helpful for me. So we'll see you next time. God bless.